Have you ever booted up a Linux distro and noticed a little tux appear? Nowadays, it's not that often you're gonna see it, as most distros have just gone and disabled it, but I do believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, that in the Gen 2 ISO, it is enabled. You're gonna see it like as soon as you open up the ISO. Sadly, it's not as simple as modifying a config option at runtime to go and enable it. This is controlled by a kernel build option. Now, considering there's an icon, you can probably tell if it's enabled in your kernel or not, but if you're unsure, what you can do is run zcat /proc/config.gz and pipe that into grep config_logo. In my case, config logo is not set. This is the default setting. This means it is going to be disabled by default. Another thing you might see is config_logo=n. This is whoever is building your kernel, whether that be you or your distro, has explicitly gone and disabled it. If you see config_logo=y, it's enabled. Now, we're not going into how to do so today. There are plenty of guides out there. Maybe I'll do so in a future video. If you want to go and enable it, you will have to go and build your own kernel if it's not enabled by default, which is annoying, but there's plenty of tooling to make it very easy. There's a whole interactive TTY CLI 2E thing that you can use. It's not that difficult, it just takes some time. Now, none of that stuff is changing anytime soon, but I've been mentioning the tux icon. The reason why I say tux instead of just some generic icon is you could change it. It just didn't have an option exposed to actually change it. So my understanding is what people were doing is basically modifying the kernel source code to load a different file, or taking the file it was loading and then replacing it with a different file, and hopefully everything's fine, because this was a completely undocumented thing to do and could break if you did something wrong, but some people managed to get it working. And because it was awkward, and because it was undocumented, not that many people do it, and you probably didn't even know, firstly, that there was a tux icon, and if you did, that it could actually be changed. If you're curious about the traditional method, there are some tutorials out there. I'm not going to cover them today, but I will leave them both linked down below if you want to go and check them out for yourself. But hopefully you won't need to use these for much longer, because the greatest patch to ever come to the kernel has been made. This is by Vincent Mailhole. Allow custom boot logo and simplify logic. Now, you're going to just be able to change the icon, and that is that. Okay, it's a little bit more complicated than that. There are some options you need to worry about. There are specific file types you need to use. So let's take a look. This series allows the user to replace the default kernel boot logo by a custom one directly in the kernel configuration. This makes it easier to customize the boot logo without the need to modify the sources, and allows such customization to remain persistent after applying the configuration to another version of the kernel. That is kind of the main issue with modifying the source. So if you were to go swap out to, say, the LTS kernel, well, now your logo was not being applied because now you didn't go and modify that kernel, and then you want to go back to another one, then you need to do it there, and then you want to change the icon, and then you need to modify it in all the kernels you're using. If it's just part of the kernel build path, just have the option set, and you're good to go. Patch 1 and 2 are cleanup and preparation, while patch 3 is the main feature of the series, making the boot logo customizable. While working on this, I realized that managing the logo file directly in KBuild allows us to simplify how we handle the different existing variants of the tux logo. This series thus ends with a cleanup which removes all the logo selection logic to KBuild, simplifying the makefile and the C code. Patch 4 and 5 do a tree-wide cleanup on the kconfig symbols that are to be removed in patch 6, and patch 6 simplifies the logic as explained above. In the replies under this, we actually have someone who was changing the icon. Marcus Raykelt. I'm gonna go Raykelt. What I've been doing for so many moons is just CP my own logo, Linux clut224.ppm, to this location here for each custom kernel build. That works like a charm. Maybe I'm too pragmatic. In 224 colors PPM, haven't tested your patch series because stuff just works for me. Looking forward to feedback from all those logo nerds out there. Are those a thing that exist? I'm just gonna go with it. In response, the patch author says, I was doing the same. I then started a rework a couple of years ago to implement this idea. At that time, I was less experienced and did not fully understand K-Build. The result worked, but was ugly and stayed in my local tree. This winter holidays, I had a bit of free time, revisited my old idea, and this time found something I thought was worth upstreaming, thus this series. So they actually had a working solution. At least, like, if they say a couple of years ago, at least 2 or 3 years ago, but it just wasn't good. It was probably very hacky. It, I would guess, probably broke from time to time, was definitely not written in a way that other people should see, and then they finally got some time to fix it. Honestly, this is the way that most things end up going. Pretty much most of my, like, personal things I have are written to be absolute garbage until I actually get some time to go and clean things up. And it's been a while since I've actually sat down and cleaned something up. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the first two patches about cleaning things up. The one we really care about is patch number 3, allow custom logo, because this one explains what you need to keep in mind. There are 3 types of icons supported: monochrome, 16 color, and 224 colors. Now, this is still going to be a kernel build option thing, so if you want to modify it, yes, you will need to, you know, go and compile your kernel, but at least now you don't need to go and modify files in the kernel, modify source code, anything like that. It's now just a kernel build option. So those options are going to be logo Linux mono file for monochrome, logo Linux VGA16 file for 16, and then logo Linux clut224 file for 224. Now, you can't just go and take a JPEG or a PNG and make that your icon. Well, you can, just not without doing some modification to it first. So for the monochrome icon, this must be a PBM file. For the colored icons, a PPM file. These are portable PixMap files. Now, you can go and make these using GIMP if you want to, just chuck the file in the GIMP and export it if that's what you want to do, but very nicely, there are some image magic commands also included here as well, if you prefer to do things from the command line. For all 3 of them, just go and run that command on the file, and you're good to go. Now, on any sort of modern system with the icon enabled, you are very likely seeing the 224 version of the icon. Do keep in mind that this is a limited color palette, so for certain kinds of icons, it might look really bad. If you want to ensure things are actually good and not an unreadable mess, make sure you're either using something which can easily convert into a lower color space, or just have something that is in that color space anyway. If you have 16 colors, just use a 16-bit sprite. If you have something else, just use something that fits in the color space and you'll have a good time. Don't have something where it has a bunch of random colors all over the place. Otherwise, it's probably going to be a bit of a blurry mess. But you would be surprised with what you can fit into 224 colors, so even if things aren't perfect for every single image, for most things, it's still probably gonna be fine. 16, maybe not so much, but 224, you should be good. Again, keep in mind this is a kernel build option, so you will have to compile your kernel. If you're not comfortable doing so, well, I can't help you there. Find someone who is and get them to compile the kernel for you. Now, as always, if you want a very, very fun time, I recommend reading through the Pharonix comments about this change. I don't know what the hell was happening here, because this immediately diverged from the actual topic. So, the image here was of Nopix, and this is like an old distro, was using barely any RAM, and all this good stuff. And then things are just about Nopix for most of the thread. And then randomly, and I don't understand how this happened, you have comments like this one for some reason. And where's this one as well? And yeah, about how Tux can't jack off and other Linux logos have hands so they can. What is this website? How is Pharonix like this? With that being said, I hope it never changes because it's always a joy to see every time I come here. Anyway, let me know your thoughts. Are you the kind of person that changes your boot icon? I don't. I just want to boot into my system. Do you care the little icon on your TTY? Probably not. But if you do, well, you can now easily change it. So, let me know your thoughts down below. If you liked the video, go like the video. Go subscribe as well. And if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Starly Barapay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and now you can boot with a Windows icon.